So in the security valuation topic, we are done with share valuation, we are done with bond valuation. We'll now go to something called as convertible instruments. We have seen valuation of convertible instruments, but now we are going to see certain terms associated with convertible instruments. From a valuation point of view, we had a minimum valuation and a maximum valuation. Basically, a convertible instrument is something which can be converted into equity shares if required, or it can continue to be a debenture or a preference share. A convertible instrument can be an optionally convertible. It can also be a compulsorily convertible. So it can be a compulsorily convertible where it will have to 100% get converted into equity, or it continues as a convertible debenture or a convertible preference share. Now there are certain terms. The first term is conversion value. Conversion value is if you convert the debentures into shares today, what is the value you get? That's technically called as conversion value. If you convert it today, whatever value we get, it's technically called as conversion value. Conversion premium is the difference between the current market price and conversion value. Is the difference between current market price and conversion value. Now, this conversion premium can be expressed as a percentage of conversion value or per equity share or per convertible instrument. I'll explain this when I do the problem. The formula is very simple. It's the difference between the current market price and the conversion value, but it can be expressed in three different ways. Straight value is basically the intrinsic value of the bond without any conversion option. Year, cash flow, PVF, DCF, do the discounting, whatever value you get, that's called the straight value of the bond or the intrinsic value of the bond. Straight value or the intrinsic value of the bond. Now, whenever I get a convertible instrument, what happens is I pay a price which is higher than its straight value or intrinsic value. Why do I pay higher prices? Because there is an option that it can get converted into a equity share and it gives me higher value. Because of that, you will end up investing little more than what is its real worth. And that difference, the extra money which you invest, subtracted by the straight value, is called as downside risk. Downside risk is in case equity shares don't perform well, the bond will come down to its intrinsic value. The bond will come down to its intrinsic value in case the equity markets are not performing well, because it's an optionally convertible one. If I convert, I get a very high value, but if I'm not able to convert because markets are not doing well, the value will crash down to its straight value. So downside risk is possible fall in value. Current market price minus intrinsic value or the straight value. This can also be expressed as a percentage of conversion value, percentage of current market price, percentage of straight value. I'll explain as we proceed. Conversion parity prices, the price at which if I do conversion, there'll be no profit, no loss. This term again I'll explain when I do the problem. The other terms I'll explain with the problem. So let's get into problem solving on this area. Convertible instruments, topic 26, page 155. Again, a frequently tested exam area. They keep asking question in this area. Let's do question 3 where we have all the adjustments. Let's do question 3. Let's do question 3 where we'll have all the items. A frequently tested exam area. Go through question 3, page 155. Page 155, question number 3. Point number 1, conversion value. Conversion value. Conversion value. If you convert this debenture into equity shares today,
what will be the value once you do the conversion? One share will be converted into how many, one debenture will be converted into 30 shares, and price of one share is 25. So if at all conversion happens, I will get a value of 30 into 25. If conversion goes through today, my value will become 750. Today it's a debenture of some 900 rupees, but if at all conversion happens, it will become 750. It will become 750 if conversion goes through. Any doubts on this? Second part they've asked, market conversion price or conversion parity price. There's a two names to it. Market conversion price or conversion parity price. Market conversion price or conversion parity price. What is the current value of the debenture? 900. Now basically what they want to know is, if share price is 25, you are saying value is 750, what should be the share price so that it continues to have 900 value? What should be the share price, the parity price, what should be the share price so that I continue to get a value of 900? You are saying 900 will suddenly become 750, I am not okay with that. What should be the share price so that I continue to get a 900 value, which is possible if 900 divided by 30. If the share price is 30 rupees, then that's great. If the share price is 30 rupees, my parity price, I'll on conversion, I'll get 900. I'll not be losing anything. If the share price touches 30 rupees, in case the share price is below 30, I should never convert. If the share price should touch minimum 30 rupees so that I can think of converting that into a equity share. That's a parity price. What was the third thing they asked? Conversion premium. Now they've asked per share, but I'll write multiple things. Conversion premium. Now listen. Conversion premium per debenture. Conversion premium per debenture. Conversion premium per debenture. What's the debenture price? 900. But if you convert, you will get only 750. So you lose 150 rupees. That's the conversion premium. As of now, you are paying a premium of 150 rupees. Per debenture, I am paying extra 150 rupees. Conversion premium per debenture is 150. Per share is, each debenture is 30 share. Each debenture is 30 shares. So the conversion premium per share is 5 rupees. Conversion premium per share is 5 rupees. Now this conversion premium can also be called as percentage of current market price and percentage of conversion value. Whatever that 150 you see, you can write the ratio as a percentage of current market price, also as a ratio of conversion value. The premium which you pay is extra 150 rupees. Now basically, it is 16.67% of current market price. Current market price is 900. 150 on 900 is 16.67%. I'm paying extra 16.67% when I look at from a current market price point of view. 16.67% of current market price. 150 is the premium. If you leave it as rupees, okay, but if you want to convert it as a ratio, it can be a ratio of current market price, which is 16, or 20% of conversion value. 20% of conversion value, which is 150 on 750. 150 on 750. 16.67% of current market price, 20% of conversion value. Any doubts on this? Any doubts on this part? Ratio of conversion premium is done. Ratio of conversion premium is done. Now, there's something called as a straight value of debenture. Straight value of debenture is nothing but the real worth of the debenture. Listen, there are three values. The real worth of the debenture is 700. If you convert into shares, you get 750. And the current market price is 900. So from a conversion point of view, I'm paying extra 150. Premium over straight value of debenture, right? Premium over straight value of debenture, premium per debenture rupees 200. Premium per debenture, you don't call it as per share because straight value is not related to share. Premium per debenture is rupees 200. Same thing, percentage of current market price, percentage of straight value. That extra 200 can be calculated as a percentage of 900. It can also be calculated a percentage of 700. You can calculate it as a percentage of, see, you are paying 900. If it is converted into share, you get 750, but the real worth is only 700. In future, if share price moves up, you will get that benefit. Otherwise, things can become difficult for the person. So, percentage of current market prices, you can do 2 by 9 of current market price. You can write the percentages. 2 by 9 of current market price, 200 on 900. 200 on 900 and 2 by 7 of straight value. You can write it as a percentage. Some 22.22% of current market price and some 29, yeah, whatever percentage you get, you can end up writing them. The premium can be expressed in rupees, can be expressed as a percentage of current market price, can be expressed as a percentage of straight value. Any doubts in this? 750 is from a conversion point of view. So if I convert, it is 750. Market price is 900. So that difference is conversion premium. They're asking premium over straight value. Yeah, so 900 is the market value and 700 is the straight value of the bond. And I don't need per share or other things here. What's the next thing they've asked? Favorable income differential. Favorable income differential per share. Favorable income differential per share. Now listen, a person can get into directly buying a share, or he does it in an indirect way of buying a debenture and later on converting it depending on certain conditions which get satisfied. Listen, interest income per debenture, can you tell me what will be the interest income per debenture? Interest income per debenture, look at the rates and tell me how much. 85. Listen, dividend income for, not per share, for 30 shares. Dividend, because one debenture is 30 shares, dividend income is 30. Now listen, when I buy a debenture, no, one, I have an option of conversion. Apart from that, if I buy shares, I'll get 30 rupees as dividend. But if I buy a debenture, I'll get 85 rupees as interest income. So listen, favorable income differential per debenture. At a debenture level, you earn extra 55 rupees per debenture by buying it as a debenture. And favorable income differential per share is this divide by 30. So when somebody buys a debenture, there's an extra benefit, which is your income differential. You will earn interest of 85 vis-a-vis a dividend of 30 rupees. So you earn extra 1 rupee 83 paise every year per share. At a per share level, I earn every year extra 1.83 rupees. Extra 1.83 rupees is what I earn every share. So though I pay a little bit extra amount when I buy a debenture, but the benefit is I'll get extra 1.83 every year. The extra 1.83 would be received every year. That's a kind of benefit which I have. Any doubts on this 1.83? Any doubts on 1.83? The last part is asking for premium payback period. Premium payback period. Any doubts on this 1.83? See, as such, premium would mean only the conversion premium, not the straight value premium. What is the conversion premium? How much is the conversion premium? Okay, listen, 150 per debenture. 150 per debenture, and every debenture I earn extra 55 rupees. Every debenture, see that extra 150 which I pay, no, I'll recover it in few years. 150 rupees what I pay, I'll recover it back in few years. Either I recover it as 150 by 55 or 5 rupees by 1.83, both are same. 5 rupees by 1.83 or 150 rupees by 55. Whatever extra amount I'm paying, first year earn 55, second year earn 55, third year you will break even or you will get the payback. Whatever extra 150 you are paying, you recover it back within some 2 point some years. So the premium payback period is 5 rupees of premium divided by income differential of 1.83. 5 rupees of premium, you can keep it as 5 by 1.83, you can also keep it as 150 by 55. 150 by 55. The only thing is both have to be consistent. Favorable income differential is a recovery mechanism for you, and premium is an extra payment which we make. Premium is an extra payment which we are making. So 150 divided by 55 or 5 divided by 1.83. Any doubts in this? Any doubts in this? We don't take discounting. We don't take, ideally should be done, but we don't take discounting in this. Ideally discounting is to be done because I don't know the discount rate to be taken. Ideally discounting is to be done. Here time value of money is ignored in the analysis. Any doubts on this? Okay, let's do question number 2. Go through question 2. Go through question 2. Okay, let's start with something called a straight value of bond. Straight value of bond is, ignore this convertible everything, year, cash flow, PVF, DCF. If no conversion happens, what is the worth of that bond? That's called a straight value of bond. Last problem, this was given directly. Here I'll have to calculate it, ignoring this conversion and all. No concept of conversion to be brought in. Working note 1, computation of straight value. Computation of straight value. Computation of straight value. Year, cash flow, PVF, DCF. Year, cash flow, PVF, DCF. Year, cash flow, PVF, DCF. How many years is the bond? Okay. You can do an annuity, you can do a normal computation. 85 rupees interest. What's the discount rate they mentioned? AAA rated bond can issue plain vanilla bonds without conversion at an interest rate of 9.5%. So a normal bond will have an interest rate of 9.5%. This bond has an interest rate of how much? 8.5. So you are paying some lower interest. Maybe you are telling them that conversion will happen, you will earn some good money. That is why maybe I opted for this. So I'll discount this at 9.5. I'll discount this at 9.5%. So this value is technically the straight value of the debenture which was given in the earlier question. Now we have calculated. The real worth of the debenture is 975. The real worth of the debenture is only 975 rupees.
the real worth of the debenture is 975.27. That's its intrinsic value or the real worth. Any doubts on this? But it is quoting at some 1175. It's quoting at 1175. The difference is the premium which you are paying, or from a straight value point of view. Any doubts on straight value of bond? Next, conversion value of bond is equal to what into what? Conversion value of bond is equal to 25 into 45. 1125, 25 into 45. If you do the conversion today, you will get 1125. If I do the conversion today, I'll get 1125. Any doubts on that? Conversion premium is rupees 50 per debenture. Extra 50 rupees, 1175 in comparison with 1125. Rupees 50 per debenture. Rupees 50 per debenture are what? Rupees 2 per share. Or they would want person, not sure what will be there in institute key. So they may ask at a debenture level, at a share level, or as a percentage of conversion value, or as a percentage of current market price. So R, it is 50 by 1175 percentage of current market price. It can be a percentage of current market price. 50 divided by 1175. 50 divided by 1175 or 50 divided by 1125. It can be a percentage of current market price. It can be a percentage of conversion value. There are multiple options. It's basically 50 divided by one of those values, 1175 or 1125. Any doubts on this? 50 by 1175 or 50 by 1125. Any doubts on this? Yeah, you will have to write all. Next, any doubts on this? Next, percentage of downside risk. Percentage of downside risk. Percentage of downside risk is nothing but this. You will compare it with straight value of debenture. You will have to compare it with straight value of debenture, because the share price, the debenture from 1175 can come down to that 975. That's the real worth. The real worth is only 975. So percentage of downside risk, percentage of downside risk from 1175, it can fall down to 975.27. From 1175, it can fall down to 975.27. I will have to finally convert that into percentage. I can write it as 17% of current market price or 20.48% of. Institute normally does one of the two, but it is not consistent. Some question they do as a percentage of current market price, some question they do as a percentage of straight value. So we have done both. The downside risk is 17% of current market price or 20.48% of straight value. 17% of current market price or 20.48% of straight value. Any doubts on this? Last one is simple. Conversion parity price. You can tell me what is a parity price. At what price we'll have no profit, no loss? 40. Check it. At 47, we'll have no profit, no loss. So that this is as far as your convertible instruments are concerned. So we have done normal instruments, normal shares, normal debt, convertible. All the three categories are done. I'll now get to the miscellaneous area, which is EVA, rights issue, and bonus issue. I'll come to first thing called as economic value added, because this is frequently tested in exam. Now listen, coming to EVA, EVA basically says that the return which a firm generates is technically called as EBIT. The return which a firm generates is called as EBIT. EBIT into 1 minus tax rate is the return earned by the company. Return earned by the company is EBIT into 1 minus tax rate. And the cost for the company is, cost of the company is nothing but the overall capital into WACC. The return of the company is EBIT into 1 minus tax rate. Cost for the company is overall capital into WACC. The difference between these two is called as EVA. It can be a positive EVA or a negative EVA. Certain rules when you calculate EVA is, just a moment, yeah. The capital employed has to be ascertained on replacement cost basis and not on book value. What is the today's value? So when I'm calculating the return and I cannot value this building at 10 lakhs because I bought it historically at 10 lakhs. The today's value could be 1 crore, 2 crore. I'll have to take the current value and not the historical value. Also, this EBIT has to be adjusted for all non-recurring items, one-time adjustment. You will have to adjust all of that and get adjusted EBIT. So EBIT may have to be adjusted, capital employed may have to be adjusted, and then you apply the formula, which is EBIT into 1 minus tax rate, invested capital into WACC. Any doubts on this? Okay, let's get to this. Let's get to question 2. I'll come to question 1 later on. Let's come to question 2. RST Limited's current financial year income statement reported its net income as 25 lakh. Net income is profit after tax. Net income is nothing but profit after tax. The applicable corporate income tax rate following is the capital structure, debt, equity, invested capital, beta, risk-free rate and average risk premium. Let's first calculate WACC. The first part of the question is asking for WACC calculation. Let's get WACC. Based on WACC, we will calculate the EVA. Working note 1, computation of WACC. Computation of WACC. Again, a simple format which we have used. Source, cost, weight, product. Source, cost, weight, product. Computation of WACC. Source, cost, weight, product. Source is basically the source of capital. We have debt. We have equity, debt and equity. We have debt and equity. What's the cost of debt given in the question? Not 11%. After tax, 7.7. Cost of debt is 7.7. Use CAPM and cost of equity. How much? 20.7. Okay, 20.74. Use CAPM and get this number, 20.74. Use CAPM and get the number, 20.74. How much is the value of debt? 40. Value of equity? 125. Sum of product by sum of weights will give you the WACC. Sum of product by sum of weights. Sum of product by sum of weights. Your weights need not add up to 1. We will just write the whatever the value is there, and we'll, once we divide, we get to the WACC. 17.58%. 17.58%. Any doubts on the WACC number? 17.58%.
working note to computation of EBIT, computation of EBIT, particulars and amount, computation of EBIT. You can reverse work and tell me this number, EBIT less interest, EBT less tax, EAT. They have given the EAT in the question. You go back and tell me the reverse work and get to EBIT number. EBIT less interest, EBT less tax and EAT. Reverse work and get back to the EBIT number. Reverse work and get to the EBIT number. What's the EAT number? 25 lakhs. This will become 3571429. 4,40,000. EBIT number is 40,11,429. That's the EBIT number. Any doubts on the EBIT number? Any doubts on the EBIT number? EVA equal to EBIT into 1 minus tax minus capital into WACC. EBIT into 1 minus tax minus capital into WACC. 40,11,429 into 0.7 into 1 minus tax rate into 1 minus tax rate 40,11,429 minus the invested capital was 165 lakhs into 17.58% into 17.58%, which is some 29,700, and EVA is some -92,700. EVA is -92,700. Invested capital into WACC, EVA in this case is -92,700. -92,700. Any doubts in this? Clear? EVA number is -92,700. Try question number 3. Please try question number 3. Try question 3.
do question number 3. Question number 3.
Operating profit is EBIT. The term operating profit is EBIT. The term operating profit would indicate EBIT. The term operating profit would mean EBIT. No, so it says they have reported 2020 after writing of 300 lakhs. So I'll have to add back this 300, but deduct 100 for every year, because 300 lakhs has a life of 3 years. So 100 anyway has to be deducted. So 2020, I'm adding back 300 and deducting 100, adding back. So next year the ideal profit is 2020. The ideal profit is 2020. Last year they should not have charged 300. They should have charged only 100. They should have written off only 100. They ended up writing off a higher amount. Reported EBIT is 2020. Adjusted EBIT is 2020. Reported is 2020. Adjusted is 2020. Now, this cost of debt is of no use in the question, because WACC is directly given. Cost of capital is WACC. They have directly given the WACC number. What is the capital employed? 8,400 lakhs. We'll have to take the capital employed to be 8,400 lakhs. So WACC is equal to 2020 into 1 minus, what's the tax rate? Not given. Okay, take it as 30%. You write your assumption. 2020 into 1 minus 0.3. Operating profit is EBIT. The term operating profit is EBIT. 2020 into 1 minus 0.3 minus 8,400 into. You can also ignore the tax also, saying that the taxes are ignored and leave it as 2020 itself. Triple 20 into 1 minus 0.3. Answer is 2020 into 0.7 minus 8,400 into some 630 lakhs. Institute may not have taken the tax rate there, so they would have done 2020 minus 8,400 into 11%. You can write an assumption on the tax. You want to ignore it, but write a note. What are you doing with the taxation has to be written. Any doubts in this? let's do question number 7. Go through this question. Go through 7. Go through question 7. Let's first compute WACC. Working note 1, computation of WACC. Working note 1, computation of WACC. Source, cost, weight, product. Source, cost, weight, product. Debt, equity. Source, cost, weight, product. Now listen. It has a net worth of 200 crores. Net worth is basically equity. And it has a long-term debt of 400 crores. But one information they're saying, there is some patent which is yet to be recorded in the books. Once I record the patent, whose value will go up? Equity or debt?
Equity,
because they are the residual people. So if patent gets recorded, the equity guys will get the benefit of the patent. So the capital employed is not 200 plus 400. The capital employed is, debt is 400, equity is 300. Equity is 300 crores. Whatever is that patent, the entire benefit of the patent will go to equity shareholders. Okay, tax is missing. Okay, let's ignore the tax for all the computation. What is the rate of bond? Any cost of debt they have given? This should not be bond portfolio, this should be market portfolio. This should be a market portfolio rather than bond portfolio. It should ideally be worded as market portfolio. So the cost of debt is 10% and cost of equity is, see, they say the stock moves in tandem with the market. So whatever return market gives, the stock will also need the same return, which is 12%. 400, 300, 10% and 12%. Okay, I have swapped this, sorry. These are weight and these are cost. We'll ignore the tax for all computation. Taxes will get ignored for all the calculation. Now this, technically you see this product, no? This is nothing but, in your EVA formula, no? What you subtract is this product. What you subtract is nothing but this product, because WACC into capital, you will multiply again with 700. So technically what is the product is basically the cost which is associated with use. Ideally, I should at least generate an income of 76 crores. If I generate an income of 76 crores, I'll meet the expectation of both the set of people. Anything excess of that is basically the EVA. Technically, the 76 crores, even in the last question, I should have done this question which we did. We have rounding off issue. I should ideally subtract by 2900.5 rather than 2900.7. That's more because of a rounding off difference. But otherwise, whatever is the product total, no, that is the minus part of the EVA formula. That's the minus part of the EVA formula. What is the income they are generating? This is taken as EBIT into 1 minus tax rate, or taken as EBIT itself. This is the EBIT they generate. So EVA is equal to 84 minus 76, or 84 minus 700 into 10.8571%. Technically it's 84 minus 76. You get it as 8 crores. EVA is 8 crores. Any doubts on this? Okay, you can try question number one. I'll just tell you one formula which you would have gone through IPCC level, but you will forget. There's this financial leverage. The formula for this is EBIT by EBT. Using this logic, you try to get to the answer. Do question number one. Before tax. EBT, no? Earnings before tax. EBIT divided by EBT. Try question number one.
EBIT number would be 120. EBIT number would be 120.
Getting WACC, all those parts are fairly simple. Source, cost, weight, product, get to the WACC, get to the EVA answer. EBIT is 120. 1.5 is equal to X by X minus 40. X will turn out to be 120. X by X minus 40. It'll turn out to be 120. It'll turn out to be 120. Any doubts in this? Clear? Can we proceed? I'll move to the next miscellaneous area now. Any doubts on EVA part? We'll move to rights issue and bonus issue. Rights and buyback, I think. Yeah, rights and buyback. Now listen. Okay.
As far as rights issue is concerned, listen, any doubts till now? Now, when it comes to rights issue, whenever a company makes a rights issue, the price at which the rights issue would be made would be lower than the normal price of the share. And whenever rights issue is made, the shareholder should either exercise the rights or sell the rights. If you allow it to lapse, the wealth will come down. If you are allowing it to lapse, the wealth is going to come down. Let's try to understand this. Question number 2, page 151. Question 2, page 151. ABC Limited share are currently selling at 13 per share. There are 10 lakh shares outstanding. The firm is planning to raise 20 lakhs to finance a new project. What are the X rights price of share and the value of the right if the firm offers one right for every 2 shares held? Firm offers one right share for every 4 shares held. How does the shareholders' wealth change? How does the rights issue increase shareholders' wealth? How many shares are there currently? 10 lakh shares. The current price is 13. The first option is offer one share for every 2 shares. So listen, I'm going to issue 5 lakh shares at 4 rupees per share because I need only 20 lakhs. My requirement is 20 lakhs. So I'll issue 5 lakh share at 4 rupees, whereas the current market price is 13. So if I'm issuing it at 4, and I'm not subscribing or not selling it, my wealth will come down, 5 lakh into 4. Second scenario, they're saying one right share for every 4 held, which means 2.5 lakh into 8. 2.5 lakh into 8. These are the number of shares and the price at which the issue would be made. If you are issuing one share for every 2, it's 5 lakh shares into 4. If it's one share for every 4, 2.5 lakh shares into 8. Clear? Any doubts on this? Any doubts on these two numbers? Now, working note 1, computation of X rights price. Computation of X rights price. X rights price is the price at which it will quote once the rights issue is over. Once the rights issue is over, at what price will it quote? X rights price is equal to, how many shares are there today? And what price do they quote? 10 into 13. 10 into 13. How many more new shares we are going to issue in the first scenario? 5 into 4. Currently 10 into 13 shares are there. Now you are suddenly saying you will issue 5 lakh shares into 4. 5 lakh shares into 4. And number of shares will go up to 10 plus 5. The number of shares will become 10 plus 5. Automatically, the price will be a weighted average of 13 and 4. It will crash a little. It will be a weighted average of 13 and 4. What's the number you get? 10. This is the X rights price. Once the rights issue is completed, it will quote at 10 rupees. Once the rights issue is completed, it is going to quote at 10 rupees. Second scenario, 10 into 13 plus 2.5 into 8 divided by 10 plus 2.5. Divide and let me know what you get. 12. So after the rights issue is completed, it will either quote at 10 rupees if you make 1:2 issue, and if you make 1:4 issue, it will quote at 12. It will quote at 12. Any doubts on this? Next, value of a right. Value of right. Now listen, I currently hold some shares in a company. I'll be given an option to buy a share at the rate of rupees 4. Unfortunately, I don't have money. If I don't have money, I can sell my rights to someone else. Now, how much will I sell this? Value of right is technically nothing but X rights price minus the rights price. See, today
somebody will buy a rights share at 4 rupees and in few days it will quote at 10 rupees. You will buy it at 4 rupees and in few days it will start quoting at 10. So value of right for the scenario 1 is 10 minus 4 rupees 6 per right. 10 minus 4 is rupees 6 per right. After the rights issue is completed, it will quote at it will quote at 10 rupees and I can buy a right share at 4 rupees. I can buy a share at 4 rupees. So nobody is going to get a benefit here. You will tell him that you buy it at 4, give me 6 rupees and you get the share for 10 rupees. You will finally get it at 10 rupees because post the rights issue is completed, it will quote at 10 rupees. Now listen, this is for every right you have. For every right you have, but having one share will not give you one right. Having one share will give you only 1 by 2 right. Having one share will give you only 1 by 2 right. So sometimes they say rupees 6 per right or rupees 3 per share. Rupees 6 per right or rupees 3 per share. Rupees 6 per right or rupees 3 per share. Any doubts on this? Now it's very simple. I hold a share worth 13 rupees today. They say they are making a rights issue. Because of the rights issue, I get 1 by 2 rights from the company. I sell that for 3 rupees. When I sell that for 3 rupees, after the sale, I get a share worth 10 rupees and cash worth 3 rupees. I was earlier holding a 13 rupees share. Now I'll hold a 10 rupees share and 3 rupees cash. I'll hold 10 rupees share and 3 rupees cash. So in rights issue, nothing will happen. Sometimes if you don't do anything with that, the 13 rupee share will become 10 rupee. 13 rupee share will automatically become 10 rupee. Either you subscribe it at 4 rupees. See, if somebody subscribes it at 4 rupees, no. Let's assume you had earlier 2 shares. When you had 2 shares, your value would have been 26. The 26 will come down to 20. That one extra share which you buy, you will buy at 4 and it will become 10. So 6 rupee loss here, 6 rupee profit there, both will match. If you subscribe to the issue, 26 will come down to 20 because the price has fallen by 3 rupees. But whatever you buy it for 4 rupees and it quotes at 10. If you don't have money, at least sell the right. At least sell the right. When you sell the right, you will get 3 rupees per share. So they've asked how shareholders' wealth is impacted. I'm going to explain that. The shareholder wealth will remain same. The only scenario where it will come down, if you don't subscribe as well as don't sell. If you don't subscribe and don't sell, 13 rupees will become 10. 13 will come down to 10. In the second scenario, value of right is 12 minus 8 rupees 4 per right or rupees 1. Here the ratio was 1 is to 4. The ratio was 1 is to 4. Rupees 4 per right or rupees 1 per share. So my share price from 13 will come down to 12 and I'll get 1 rupee here. I get my 13 rupees. I get my 13 rupees. Any doubts on this? Any doubts on the rights issue part? Let's do a problem on buyback. Go through the question on buyback. Okay, now when it comes to buyback as a tool, what can happen is it can increase the wealth of the shareholder as well as the company. The reason is when I have some surplus money, I'll not be in a position to earn any returns on that. So what I do is I go for a buyback. When I go for buyback, I buy back certain shares. That money was not utilized anywhere. So my overall earnings will remain same. What was there earlier, it will continue to remain same. If that money was not deployed anywhere, if there was no good usage of money,
overall earnings will remain same, but the denominator number of shares will come down now. The denominator of the number of shares will come down, and because of that, EPS will move up and price will also end up moving up. So buyback can lead to wealth increase if you are returning money which is not being used by the company. If you are using some money and then returning it, it will not have any impact. If there is some money which is not being utilized by the company and then you opt for a buyback, it will lead to a wealth increase. The other thing is, there are certain rules on buyback which, from a law point of view, that we are not worried. Here they'll give you certain factors, based on that you decide how much to buy back. Let's look at this question. The company has a surplus cash of 100 lakhs. It wants to distribute 27%. So they want to distribute 27 lakh. They want to distribute 27 lakh. Company has decided to buy back share. Finance manager estimates that share price after repurchase is likely to be 10% above the buyback price. That is, buyback price is going to be X and share price after buyback is 1.1X. It will go up by 10%. The number of shares outstanding at present is 10 lakh. EPS is 3. You are required to determine price at which shares can be repurchased if the market cap of the company would be 210 lakhs after buyback. Number of shares that can be repurchased, impact of share repurchase on the EPS, assuming that net income is the same. EPS will go up if net income is going to remain same. Working note 1, computation of
number of shares to be bought back and buyback price. Computation of number of shares to be bought back and buyback price. Computation of number of shares to be bought and buyback price. Okay, particulars and amount. Okay, now listen. After the buyback is completed, the value is going to be 210 lakhs. That's what they have mentioned. So point number one, just a minute. Okay, point number one, number of shares bought back, let's call it as Y. Number of shares bought back is Y. Price at which buyback is done is X. Price at which buyback is done is X. I will be buying back Y shares, and price at which I buy back is X. Buyback size. The buyback size is 27 lakhs. The buyback size is 27 lakh. And this is nothing but X into Y. The 27 lakhs is nothing but X into Y. Number of shares bought back and the price at which the buyback has happened. So I'm going to do a buyback of 27 lakh rupees, and that's nothing but X into Y. Number of shares into the price at which the buyback has happened. Any doubts on this? Point number four, market cap post buyback. How much? 210 lakhs. Market cap post buyback is going to be 210 lakhs. Market cap post buyback is going to be 210 lakhs. Once the buyback is completed, you will have 210 lakhs worth of value. Shares post buyback, how many original shares were there? 10 lakhs. Post buyback, you will see 10 lakh minus Y. Post buyback, you will see 10 lakh minus Y. Today, 10 lakh shares are there. Once the buyback is completed, the shares will fall to 10 lakh minus Y. Post buyback price. Post buyback price, listen for a minute. Post buyback price is 1.1x. post buyback price is 1. Listen for a minute. It's 1.1x because they have said after the buyback is completed, the price will be 10% higher. This is one way. The other way is it is 2 crore 10 lakh divided by 10 lakh minus y. 2 crore 10 lakh divided by 10 lakh minus y is equal to 1.1x. If you do cross multiplication, you will get to the answer for x and y. Somewhere this 27 lakh value will be used and you will get to know what is the buyback price and how many shares are bought back. The post buyback price is 1.1x or rho 4 by rho 5 or rho 4 divided by rho 5. Get to the answer now. Get to the x and y. Let me know the x and y. One point one x is equal to 210 lakhs divided by 10 lakh minus y. It goes this side. 11 lakh x minus 1.1 x y equal to 210 lakhs. 1.1xy, xy is nothing but 27 lakh. X is equal to 239.7 divided by 11. That will be the buyback price. Can you just check whether, how much the price? 21.8. Exactly. 239.7 divided by 11. 0.79. Okay. How much you got? 21.79? 99. 99. Okay, 21.8. The price at which the buyback will happen is 21.8. The price at which we are going to do a buyback is 21.8. Any doubts on 21.8? Any doubts on 21.8? And number of shares bought back is 27 lakhs divided by 21.8. 27 lakh divided by 21.8. $1,23,853 share. Any doubts on this? Any doubts on 123,853 shares? 1,23,853 shares would be bought back by the company. Post buyback, I'll be left with so many shares. And the value of them was 21.80 into 1.1. This should match to 210 lakhs number. This should match 210 lakhs. Once the buyback, that's the difference is more because of rounding off. Post the buyback is completed, you need to have a value of 210 lakhs. That is 10 lakh minus 123,853. 10 lakhs minus 123,853, and once the buyback is completed, price will go up by 10%. 21.8 into 1.1. 21.8 into 1.1. So that number is 210 lakhs. It's broadly 210 lakhs number. Any doubts on this? Any doubts on this? Next, EPS post buyback. EPS post buyback. EPS post buyback. What was the original EPS? 3. Now, if my net income is going to remain same, my EPS will increase from 3. what will be the net income earlier? 3 into 10 lakhs. It is 3 into 10 lakhs, but not divided by 10 now. It is divided by lower number of shares. The shares have come down, and because of that, EPS will increase. 3 into 10 lakhs. 3 into 10 lakhs divided by 10 lakh minus 1, 2, 3. How much it was? 1, 2, 3? 8, 5? So it will become 3.42. Once the buyback is completed, EPS will move to 3.42. Any doubts on this? Clear? I'll end today with this. Portfolio is something I'll start fresh tomorrow. So we'll start with portfolio. Portfolio will go on for maximum, mostly till 9 o'clock. With that, 9 or maybe it can go till 10. With that, new syllabus will get over. Balance will be old syllabus, which is capital budgeting and leasing and the other areas. We'll see tomorrow.